Buenos días, muchachos y muchachas. ¿Cómo estás? Bien. I knew somebody who knew the answer to that question. Thank you for joining us this morning, and thank you for setting your alarm clock to Anglican 10 o'clock, which is now 9:45. I want you, if you would please, to just kind of turn your gaze over to your right and welcome Donna, okay, and Carol, who are joining us for the first time. They transferred their membership from Holy Spirit Anglican Church in San Diego. And so it's a delight to have you join us this morning and every morning from now on. And be friendly because we'll have all this extra talk time if the minister doesn't preach too long for Sunday morning. Don't nod. That's not nice. Well, so are you ready to go? Okay. Just let me say a word about masks in the sanctuary. We're gonna be. Raise it back. There we go. Okay. We're gonna play it really cool about what's going on with the current rise in cases because most, if not all of you, have been vaccinated. So we're gonna be really good about that. Keep things normal. If anything changes, we'll let you know. But up until this point, enjoy. So let's stand together this morning. This is a beautiful song from the Fount of Every Blessing. You'll see why all of the songs have to do with water this morning as we go along through the service. Are you ready? I don't want to give it away. That would be a spoiler. So sing along with me. My Blessed be God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Let us pray together, Almighty God. To you all hearts are open. All desires known, and from you those secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that I may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We gather to worship because Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Father, abundant water gushed over Israel as they left the empty desert and entered the promised land. Jesus, our living water, fills our emptiness, giving us new and eternal life, and flowing as springs of ministry to others. For this gift, we thank and praise you, and all said,
Amen.
You may be seated. I'm going to take a few minutes to read scripture this morning. Let's ask God to speak to us as the Holy Spirit helps scripture come alive in us. Deuteronomy 8, verses 1 to 10, describes a loving God who saves the Israelites from their wilderness experience and pours out abundant blessing by restoring them to a land overflowing with his goodness.
If this one doesn't work, press the keypad.
But I command you to do it. You shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land that the Lord swore to give you to your fathers. And you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you and let you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, that man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out on you, and your foot did not swell these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, the Lord your God disciplines you. So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and by fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and springs, flowing out in the valleys and hills, and land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, and a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills you can dig copper. And you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Psalm 34, verses 1 to 7. It's a song of the soul coming alive after the soaking rain of God's love and deliverance. And Jean's going to lead us as we sing together.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord. Of the Lord. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord. The goodness of goodness of all that old time. feast and see the goodness of the Lord. The goodness of the Lord. Glory in the goodness be. Let us together extol his name. I sought the Lord and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord. Look to him that you might be radiant with joy and your faces free from all shame. The Lord hears the suffering souls and saves them from all distress. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord, the goodness of the Lord.
Ephesians chapter 4, verses 17 to 5:2 reminds us of who we are before Jesus drowns our soul in his love, creating new lives immersed in God to be truly righteous and blessed.
They're two different things.
Let's read it together. Now this I say and testify to the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and yet given themselves up to sensuality, meaning to practice every kind of impurity. But that is not the way you learn of Christ. Assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in you, as the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth as neighbor. For we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice. God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Verses 4 to 42 is the beautiful story of life in drought, until Jesus comes along and douses it to overflowing with him, the living water. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now Jesus had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey and down by the well, it was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Would you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You're a Jew, and I'm a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" And Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water, so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You're right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you've had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you're a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet there's a time coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah," called Christ, "is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I, the one speaking to you, am he." Just then, his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you talking with her?" Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah?" They came out of the town and made their way toward him. Meanwhile, his disciples urged him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you know nothing about." Then his disciples said to each other, "Could someone have brought him food?" "My food," said Jesus, "is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Don't you have a saying, 'It's still 4 months until harvest'? I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even now the one who reaps draws a wage and harvests a crop for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. Thus the saying, 'One sows and another reaps,' is true. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you've reaped the benefits of their labor." Many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 days. And because of his words, many more became believers. They said to the woman, "We no longer believe just because of what you said. Now we've heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior of the world, the gospel of the Lord."
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And beneficiaries of the most beautiful love story in cosmic history. Now, I know you thought your love story with your spouse was the greatest, but this one's even bigger, and it makes that love story possible. Sirs, we want to see Jesus. Right translation or not? Needs better, right? So, according to the actual Greek text, sirs, we want to know Jesus. John 1:21. So we're recognizing through this series, there's a difference between knowing about Jesus and knowing Jesus. In other words, we want to try to get inside his heart and mind, and then let his heart and mind inside us. That's the key, knowing Jesus. So in week one, we began by looking at his lineage. Remember that? We found out that gender and race and your past matter to Jesus because he came to include you in the family of God through his salvation. He loves you. So there's no barrier whatsoever to your being in the kingdom of God. Weeks 2 to 4, we talked about Jesus' spiritual formation and those three parts, wisdom, maturity, and grace, and how they can be building blocks in our lives, principal building blocks that keep attaching to all the things that God teaches us by the Holy Spirit. Week 5 demonstrates the 5-point ministry strategy he used and taught his disciples to use. And his disciples mean us too. Week 6, we learn 7 things that we need to lose most to gain the one thing we need in order to really know Jesus. And what is that? Last week, I almost walked out. I did walk out. What is the one thing we need to learn?
Him never leaves.
Travis, what's the one thing we need to learn? Don't worry, you weren't here.
Him never leaves.
But he's always with us. Remember? Yeah. He's always with us, and we needed to lose all that stuff that told us, that tells us that he's not with us, like supernaturalism. Oh, God is supernatural. Well, yeah, if you're not a believer, but if he's God and you're a believer, you know him, it's just a natural way to live. Right? Okay, week 7. Knowing Jesus is eating him. Why? Because he's the bread of life. Every moment, so that he nourishes our heart, soul, mind, and strength as we love God, others, and ourselves now and for eternity. Man, if we could ingest that truth and make that real in our lives, would it ever change the way that we look at things? So what is week 8's question? How does the human soul thrive without knowing Jesus. And notice that knowing Jesus has turned to blue. There's a reason. Because thriving is water. Now, we're Californians, so we know about water, right? Well, at least we know that it butts up to our land. We don't know too much about it falling out of the sky, but we do know that thriving is water. And I find it amazing as I drive through our communities to see all of the vegetation that we've been able to put here. By the way, if we didn't have those little pipes running everywhere, we wouldn't have what we have here. We're in a desert. Notice the places where those little pipes don't run. Not even weeds can grow. We don't have very many insects because it's so dry. That means we don't have as many birds because there is not enough food for all those birds. So we ought to know about water. Did you know that up to 60% of your adult body is composed of water? A little more water in your brain and your heart, you'd sort of think so. A lot more water in your lungs, 83%. Your skin, 64% water. Muscles and kidneys, 79%. Even your bones have 31% water. So can you even survive without water? Impossible. Normally, you can survive for 3 to 6 days without water. However, after 3 days, organs begin shutting down. Much damage is inevitable and death is likely. So without water, our lives are pretty fragile. So this morning, I want to tell you a story about water. I'm going to do it a little differently than I normally do it. In fact, I didn't tell Rose this morning. I'm doing something that I've never done before. I have a whole bunch of pictures with a story about living water and Jesus. I've never done it quite this way. And what I've done is I've taken the story and put the background in up at the beginning because I've included that Ephesians text that talks about how the Gentile world lives. And I've superimposed it on all the husbands of the woman who came to the well. Guys, you're going to take a hit for a little while until you get to husband, well, not husband, number 6. And then he's going to be kind of like a redeemer. And then we're going to meet Jesus. Are you ready for this? I wish I had music in the background for this. Okay, here we go. Pay attention to the pictures. It's the hottest part of the day. A perfect time for a desert walk. Isn't that when you like to walk outside in the hottest part of the day? She goes to the well. Notice the word, empty. Empty happens to drought lives. Empty doesn't thrive. It just survives. Empty is her story. Husband one was young and sweet, handsome and attractive, full of life and sensuality. But she was never enough for him. His wandering heart followed his eyes, and he left her empty. Husband two was a little older, but willing to save her. They were happy for a while, but he became callous, cold, indifferent. He could not abide small imperfections. Wives, you know that you're all perfect. It's your husbands that are the problem, right? And what happened? He left her. How? Empty. Husband three was older still, a wealthy man, but a skilled deceiver. Falsehood was his game. And when he tried to sell her for impurity, she ran. He divorced. This time, she left. Still empty. Husband four was insufferable from the beginning. He nursed horrible, unbridled anger. He beat her with words and fists. He hurled her out like garbage, leaving her empty. Husband Five was a corrupt, dishonest lech who put a roof over her head. He never touched the trophy wife who made him look good, didn't say goodbye, never divorced her. He left her empty again. So husband Six bears an invisible asterisk. Because she is not divorced, she cannot remarry. Yet he takes her in and treats her with grace and kindness. She is alive, only somewhat empty. She expects empty at the well. But a quiet stranger fills her space. He asks for a drink and talks and talks and talks and talks. She doesn't want talking. She just wants to get her water and go. But Jesus keeps talking. Just like guys, right? Guys talk and talk and talk and talk, and ladies are quiet. I know that probably sounds like a really sexist statement, but I needed you to laugh because I saw in your eyes, wow, this poor lady. He's full of water now, but also questions. But she's tough. She gives it right back, pressing hot buttons for the Jews and the Samaritans, like gender and race. But you're a Jew and I'm a woman, implied you're a man. History and ancestry, this is Jacob's will. He gave it to us, not you, the Jews. Worship and holy spaces, you worship in Jerusalem. Tell us that that's where we need to worship. We worship on the mountain. Together and separate. For Jews don't associate with Samaritans. In fact, in another passage of scripture, the Samaritans are called dogs who don't eat off the same plates. Emptiness is the result. There should be no connection between Jesus and the woman. None whatsoever. He should never have asked for a drink. She should never have been obligated to give it to him. It should have been a quiet encounter where Jesus backs away, she does her work, and goes home. Jesus then lets her and us know him. Read that scripture passage with me. Whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. It will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. This is a remedy for empty. This takes you from surviving to thriving. And she can't help but respond. Read it with me. Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water. She's in desperate need for full because she's been empty for so long. Then he hits her empty button. Jesus makes observations. Yeah, you've had five husbands. I put it in red. It just felt like an appropriate color. And the sixth is a non-husband. Even though in the story that we sort of put together for the beginning of this homily, husband six may be the savior husband. Is this unique? Does she come to this well on that hot day saying, I'm the only woman that's ever been treated this way in my culture? It sounds to me like there's a lot of wife swapping going around in this culture. It sounds to me like serial marriage rather than monogamy is what's going on. We don't know anything about that in our culture. Unless you watch The Young and the Restless, where everybody's been married to everybody else at least once, maybe twice or five times. They've all had children with each other. Amazing. Are human beings different from one generation to the next? Well, not if you believe the writer of Ecclesiastes. There's nothing new under the sun. We still victimize women in the same way that they were being victimized in Sychar. Now, Pastor Bill, you've gone from preaching to meddling. You're starting to talk about our culture. You're starting to say, maybe things shouldn't be this way. Or maybe if more people yielded to Jesus and followed his way, we wouldn't have a culture like this. What you might be saying, Pastor Bill, is we're all involved in a potential solution. Maybe people don't know a better way of it. Of course they do. There are preachers all over TV, radio. They listen. Surprise, no, they don't. No, they don't. So the way of Sychar becomes the way of Carlsbad. The way of Sychar becomes the way of San Diego. The way of Sychar becomes the way of California. And what California produces in terms of movies becomes the way of the world. Serial marriage, victimized women. I will never forget watching Phil Donahue about 100 years ago and listening to story after story of his guests who were women who had helped their husbands become rich and famous and then got dumped, and how angry they were. And you know what? I got angry too. Because nobody should be treated like that. Nobody should be treated like that. And some of you have been. And many people you know are being treated exactly that way. No one cares. It's become so deeply ingrained in our culture. We're all satisfied with the way things are. Well, maybe we're not satisfied. Maybe with our Christian friends, we say, it's not right what's going on. We don't make any move to change it. We don't tell anybody about the option. We leave them empty, not full. She reflects. Empty can be full. She sees a vision she's never experienced before. Living water. No more empty. And suddenly she begins to realize that Jesus is the living water. He's more than a man. He's more than a Jew. He's more than a prophet. Jesus is the Messiah or the Christ. He is the Savior of the world. Did you see the development that went on through the story? She came from a place of not knowing him at all to understanding who he really is. Jesus isn't just a great ethical teacher. He's the essential reality in our lives. And because of that, we have the ethics that we have. But you can't have the ethics without having the essence. The two must be entwined. So she's now full and thriving, and she goes. But notice what she's got in her arms. We'll come back to that. The disciples return. They're filled. Why? Because they went into town and bought food. But they're empty because they didn't put themselves in the presence of Jesus to see this interaction going on. They didn't see Jesus unafraid to engage a woman who came at the time of day when nobody else would be there so she could avoid all the other women in town who, by the way, already knew what she'd done. Already knew how she'd been victimized, because probably many of them were too. They were empty, unknowing, uncaring. And did you see what it said in the text? They didn't ask, "What do you want?" to the woman. And they didn't say to Jesus, "Did somebody bring you food?" They were so oblivious to what had gone on. They were just sort of happy. "Hey, Jesus, we're going to have a picnic." But Jesus is full. "You think we need food, but I have food that you know not of. I just introduced the soul to God. I just took somebody from being empty to being full." Oh boy, what a thrill. And look what happens. Remember I asked you, what does she have in her arms? Well, she had the water bag that was used to pull water up from out of the well. But look what she left behind. Her water jar. She left more than that. She left empty behind. Because she was now full. And she was now full forever. No more. Was that your experience when you met Jesus? Do you remember what that was like? When did it happen? When you were really young and your parents told you, "We baptized you. We made promises on your behalf. We're keeping those truths." Or was it a little bit later when you made your confirmation and learned your catechism? And you confessed your faith in front of the bishop and in front of the congregation? Or was it later when you'd gone through all of those things, but it was just kind of a way of living that everybody was doing, but suddenly, somehow, heaven broke through in your soul. You got doused with living water. Maybe when you were told about Jesus in a new way, or maybe when the Holy Spirit, it felt like, came on you in a way that you've never experienced before, and suddenly you were not just surviving, you were thriving, you were alive. When did that happen? Do you think other people need to know the same thing? I believe with all my heart. I want to see people, and I know you want to see people, leave empty behind forever. So why tell this story of living water this way? Because everyone's empty and needs living water. Remember that slide? You think that's important? Water is 60% of who you are, but Jesus, the living water, is 100% of what we all need to thrive and never be empty again. 60, 100. I'd like to give somebody here $60. Anybody a taker? Or are you going to wait for me to say, "I'd like to give you 100? Who would like $60? Who would like $100? Since none of you raised your hands and I came prepared, none of you are getting anything. Because if you'd stuck up your hand, I would have given you either $60 or $100 this morning. and only Dave even said anything. And here's why I did what I did. Because we've all become complacent enough, we're not ready for the offer. And we're not ready for the offer, and we don't believe the offer is going to be real, we're not going to access it. We're going to sit there like, nah, that can't be true. He doesn't really mean it. He's a preacher. Preachers use examples. I've been here 5.5 years. You should know. I'm going to surprise. But I'm $100 richer. That's not the way we need to engage our world. We need to be making that offer just as Jesus did. So let's invite them to the well. Is this the well? I mean, this is what this looks like outside. Is this the well? Is it the well? If it's the well, no. If it's not the well, do this. Who's the well?
Jesus.
No, we're the well. We're the well because he's the water. Here, let's try that again. We're the well because he's the water. Say it with me. We are the well. Because he is the Father. The passage in Deuteronomy this morning said, for the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water and fountains and springs flowing out in the valleys and hills. The Israelites were regaining what they had lost because they had spent so long in Egypt. Our culture has spent a lot of time in the Egypt of our world. So Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I will give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. His point, leave empty forever. Get That's the message we bring. And we don't know Jesus until we know his heart for people who are empty and his vision for people to become full. Want to know Jesus? Go home today. Fill up a glass of water. Put it on your countertop and don't drink until tomorrow morning. You'll survive, but you won't thrive. And our world is barely surviving. So we can curse the dark, to change my metaphor. We can curse the dark. Or we can light candle. We can curse the emptiness. Or we can offer living water. Because, say it with me, we're the wells. He's the water. Just one more time. We're the wells.
He's the water.
So week 8, knowing Jesus leaves empty behind forever, be filled and keep being filled to overflow with living water. Come to the wells. In other words, when we leave here today, we are not going to be leaving with the recessional plane. We are leaving with the missional procession. We are missionaries. We are going out. We want to see these chairs full. We want to see souls plump and alive because they've been filled with living water, not wizened and dry, because they're empty. James chapter 1, verse 22, incarnate the word, don't just hear it. Now we get to practice. Let's pray. First, fill me up. Second, make me a well from our world. Ready? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, fill us up. Fill us up. Maybe we've never heard the story like we've heard it this morning. Maybe we've never seen the application for our lives until this morning. Maybe it's been so long since we heard the story and felt the application that we've gotten kind of dry ourselves. Lord, fill us up. And then let us overflow. What a picture that would be in a desert of a well that's just overflowing water. That just doesn't happen. You need to peer way down in the well and see if there's anything left in a desert well. But Lord Jesus, you promised to fill us up so that the water is overflowing. That would create an oasis. And Lord, that's what you call Philemon. Philemon was an oasis in his world, who took people who were useless and made them useful. Lord, give us your grace. Teach us this lesson so that we never forget. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Folks, I don't have it in me to do this naturally. Naturally, I'm kind of a quiet person. I don't mind interacting with people all day long, but then I need my space. So I need God to help me. So the end of the sermon is a prayer.
Let us know Jesus so that the living water fills us to overflowing with new life every earthly moment, causing us to minister in love for God and to others now and eternally. Lord, in your mercy, for the peace of the whole world, and for the well-being and the unity of the people of God, Lord, in your mercy, for Archbishop Foley, Bishop Keith, and for all the clergy and people of our provincial diocese and deanery, congregation, Lord, in your mercy. For all those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others, Lord, in your mercy. For our brothers and sisters in Christ who are persecuted for their faith, Lord, in your mercy. For our nation, for those in authority, and for all in public service, Lord, in your mercy. For all those who are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, and any other adversity, Lord, in your mercy. For those who have departed this life in the certain hope of the resurrection, in thanksgiving, let us pray, Lord, in your mercy. Please add your petitions and thanksgivings.
Pray for my son, Mark.
Lord God, please come down upon this congregation and not just fill us with the water of life, but give us the strength and the courage to look into the world and see the problems and step forward and help take care of them by introducing those who need help to you. And being that well, Lord, protect us and guide us. Lord, for all those who are having birthdays this week, anniversaries and celebrations, give blessings, Lord, and thank you. Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you, thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in your great mercy, you promise forgiveness of sins to all of us who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to you. Have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness and bring us to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're promised if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. These are words of comfort. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with your spirit.
You have 90 seconds to say all of the substantial welcome that you can. And then we'll come back. Today we're going to be extending the peace 30 more seconds, so you have 2 minutes. One seventeen, one eighteen, one nineteen, one nineteen and a half, one nineteen and three quarters. One 19 and 8 tenths. One 19 and 9 tenths.
He ran into someone in the
room. Oh, good. One 19 and 9 twentieths. 19 twentieths. 2 minutes. Carol and Donna, they put up with this for almost 6 years. I don't know why, but it's what it is. Okay, our course in philosophy called What Were You Thinking? Is taking a break until September. So enjoy. Bible study and evening prayer, normally on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m., restarts on August 18th. You have one more week to just go wild and crazy in your sandals and your Hawaiian shirts. But then we're back to business on Wednesday nights at 7. Remember to bring plastic and aluminum cans. We turn those into ministry money. And all of those things that are there, which we do, by the way, in some way, shape, or form, all happen because tithes, offerings, and almsgiving make it possible. So please be generous. That's the key. And remember that each one of us can reach another person by giving one George per person per Sunday. George was an Anglican, by the way. He built two churches. I served in one and I was ordained in the other. And we do that. We reach South San Diego through Emmanuel Anglican Church, a new church plant, and with our buddy Travis and his wife Kelsey, who are working with us to work with university and college students. So make sure, stick those in, and if you miss, make sure you make it up, because we want to make sure and provide for all those needs. Put yourself in a giving frame of mind as we listen to April and just enjoy God's grace as we give.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted, the head above all. All things come from you, O Lord.
And on your own have we given you.
Amen. Everyone who's a follower of Jesus Christ is welcome table this morning. We just simply ask that you receive a wafer, and then we have a kind of flattish disc with a little bit of consecrated wine. And we just ask that you dip your wafer, just the edge of it, in the wine. That way we can do communion in both kinds. I know that there are those of you who want more of the wine. And it's not for anything other than you want more of Jesus. And you've been scooping. But I'm just going to warn you that the wafers are kind of fragile. You might scoop, break, and then you go, what do I do? At that point, if that happens, if you're a scooper and that happens, then just come back to me. I'll give you another wafer and we'll figure out, we know what to do when something like that happens. But just if you dip the edge in, I know that some of you are longing for the day, as I am, when we can get more. But right now, it's enough. Is that all right?
Yes.
Okay. Let's begin by confessing our faith. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is your living word from before time and for all ages. By him you created all things, and by him you made all things new. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven who forever sing these hymns to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Seated or stand or kneel as we continue to pray. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had sinned against you and became subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death, we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice, praise, and thanksgiving. And we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit, that they may be for your people the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Sanctify us also, that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we with him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and bring us with all your saints into the joy of our heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, for by him and with him in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, both now and forever. Amen. Let us sing as we pray.
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all that is evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you alone take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you alone take away our sins and the sin of the world.
Grant us your peace.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God, so take them in remembrance. Christ died for you. And feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
go, we have to make other sign gestures, then we go forward.
stand and let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food, for the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out on mission to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as joyful witnesses of Christ our Lord, in the peace and presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Let us share Jesus and do practical works of compassionate love, nursing and service, to bring honor and glory to your name, and healing, help, and hope to all we need, both now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. And may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Chose this song because it kind of reminds us of the woman that we heard about this morning. Laura Story sings a song about how we ask for God's blessings and sometimes we just miss what God's already doing for us.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering, and all the while you hear each spoken need. Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleep nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. We cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. When friends betray us. life is the revealing of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy. And what if trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, all your mercies in disguise?
Go ahead and sit down real quick. Pastor Bill said I can do a quick testimony. We've been having all these sermons on knowing Jesus. Not knowing about Jesus, but knowing Jesus. And how to go about letting other people get to know Jesus. And I had a story that happened 2 weeks ago on a Saturday morning with my group of men that meet every Saturday. We're at a restaurant, we walk in, there's a gentleman there, and he's talking about, he's ordering, and he says, I want a scrambled egg, two scrambled eggs, bacon, no toast, no potatoes, and a salad. How many diabetics do I have in here? You know, yeah. If you hear that, you know right away what that person is. He's a diabetic. There's three guys that I eat breakfast with every Saturday that are diabetic. So we started kidding them. Hey, you know, what are you? Type 2, type 1? But he was pretty diabetic. But his wife was making him eat good. And I said, as I am, because I'm not scared of, you know, talking, is, hi, I'm JR. And she stuck out my hand. And he goes, I'm C from Boston. And I said, well, I'm JR from Boston. And we started talking some more. And I said, what you doing out here? He goes, well, my dad has died. And I'm out here from Boston to be with him as he passes. And so the guys got together and we prayed for him. Six guys, strangers, as this guy has never seen before in his life, but laid hands on him and prayed for him. And these are some of the most curmudgeon guys that you've ever wanted to see. Kevin, who sits right there, has probably never talked to any of you, is the leader. So then we were eating, and he gets up, and he comes over, and he starts talking to us again because he's leaving. And we said, well, where's your wife? He goes, well, my wife is back east with our daughters. My wife has bipolar, and she has arthritis, that nasty arthritis that attacks everything. He has another daughter who has been in a car accident, and she has brain damage. And another daughter who has bipolar also. So $3, he has one. But he says it's semi-normal. We start praying again. And he's a Christian. But he's a Christian with no life raft. And we prayed with him and gave him our cards and everything else. And he's got to us, everything's going okay. But the moral of this teaching is, if you don't listen to what's going on around you in the world, you won't know who to help. You have to listen. You know, I think Bill said it a couple of times, you have 2 ears. And then ask God for the words. So, hallelujah! Let us go into the world rejoicing in the peace and the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. We are free.
In Christ we go.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah.